Are we good? Welcome this morning to Lansing, Battle Creek, First Church of the Nazarene. I said Lansing for so many years. I knew I'd eventually say that. But happy Mother's Day to all moms. We have moms right here in the room. Mind you, not very many now. But we do have moms in the room, and I want to just say happy Mother's Day. I certainly miss my mom, and Mother's Day was always very special to me. Well, you know, Peter tells us that we are to love each other with the love that is from God. And that's a high order, to love each other with the love that is from God. In 1 Peter chapter 2, we read this: "Therefore, rid yourselves of all malice and all deceit, hypocrisy, envy, and slander of every kind. Like newborn babies, crave pure spiritual milk, so that by it you may grow up in your salvation. Now that you have tasted, the Lord is good. As you come to him, the living stone rejected by humans, but chosen by God and precious to him, you also, like living stones, are being built into a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood, offering spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ." I want you to notice there that Peter reminds us about the spiritual nature, of our relationship with God. That's how we worship Him, in spirit and in truth. Well, I want to look at happy birthdays. There's only one that I have to mention right now, and that is Neva. Miss Neva, her birthday is this coming week. And you know, if I'm missing your birthday, and you know, and it's in May, you know, text it to me. Text me just the month and the day, not the year. I don't, you know, in case you don't want me to know your age. But text it to me, and I'll make sure that we mention your birthday or even an anniversary. Who knows? We may not have all of them right. With that, let's praise the Lord this morning in song, and I know that all of heaven will be smiling.
Amen. His love is amazing, yes. Unchanging.
I won't turn back, I know you are near.
Thank you.
Thank you for a living hope. You know, as we come to this prayer time, I want to just mention to you the Harper. He's a two-year-old friend of Pastor Tabitha. He has a respiratory infection, but also a collapsed heart valve on top of that. So let's pray for this two-year-old. That's a lot for a two-year-old. And also keep my cousin Alan. He is there in Seguin, Texas. And keep him in your prayers. He has surgery this week to remove a cancer from him. And everything, God has just made a way for Alan to get this done. And I know I had the opportunity to speak to him yesterday via the video online. So we got an opportunity to talk. And I tell you, I know that he is trusting God with this. Also, Ruth and her sister, this is Ruth W., you'll know who she is. Her sister is in, I think she is in stage 4 cancer now. I think she is at that place where the doctors can't do anything else. And we need to pray for Ruth's sister. I do not have her name on here, but God knows her name. And so we give her to the Lord today. I want to also mention, I heard from Jerry this morning. And her dad, George, is at the emergency room. He is experiencing some pain. And so they are there. I don't know. I didn't check my phone before I came in here. But let's pray for George and lift him up, that this pain will go away and it'll be okay. And also I have on here, let's remember our pastoral search, and let's pray for the board that they will have the guidance, and they'll know what God wants for this church here. And so let's keep praying for the pastoral search process and the people. This is people we're praying for. They're involved in this and trying to make a decision and listen for the Holy Spirit's guidance. One thing I'll say to you is, I don't, and I think this is God, you know, we're not desperate, are we? Because God's taking care of us. And so we want to be very deliberate. We want to be know what God wants for us here. Also, the DS, the district superintendent search that is going on even now. Let's pray for that leadership that we need. We want whoever it is that God has for us. And I know He's already decided that, no doubt. We just need to catch up with God, don't we? That's usually what prayer is about, is catching up with God. Because He's already working. Also, I want to pray for moms. Each and every mom that's listening, and even those who are not. If your mom is still alive, say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
There you go. And you should be saying, text it out there, your mom's still alive. But you know what? Even if she's not, say, text hallelujah. Because I know that your mom loved you. And you love your mom. So let's do that today. I am so excited about moms. My mom has been in heaven now for well over 12 years. It's hard to believe that I've been without her that long. But I tell you, one thing I know, if there's any way mom can be looking down, if there is now, I know she might have a smile today. Because all 8 of her children know the Lord. And they're either worshiping or serving God in some way or another. And so I know my mom has got the biggest smile, probably the prettiest smile in heaven, of course. But be my mom now, right? No, but your mom too. So let's pray for that. Let me go to the Lord in prayer. And also one praise, Mindy, who is Martha B's cousin, has reported to me, I think last night, I believe, that surgery went well for Mindy. And she's at home now recovering. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. Our Heavenly Father, thank you so much. Today I would thank you for your Son, Jesus, that he has come, that he has been victorious. He is no longer in the grave. Oh, that he is at your right hand now, and he is speaking for us. And he is speaking to us through the Holy Spirit. Oh, Lord, thank you for moms. Lord, I would especially pray for all moms. Being a mom has got to be the toughest job, Lord, on this planet. It's got to be. And Lord, I pray for moms. Oh, I lift them up, that you would give them strength. We know they have all the love. They love us. But Lord, would you give them strength today? Also, Lord, these that I have mentioned, Lord, the little Harper, and oh, that little small body and needing all of this attention right now, Lord. I would pray for him. Lord, I would pray for my cousin Alan. Lord, you know Alan, and Alan knows you. I pray for strength for him now as he enters into this surgery, Lord. I would pray that you would go before him. You would prepare the way. You would prepare the surgeon. And the surgeon would have the best day he has ever had. Lord, I think about Ruth's sister right now. Oh, to be in the place that she's in, I would pray that she is trusting you, Lord. That she would know that it's going to be okay. Lord, you've got this. Oh, Lord, would you comfort her and give her strength? Lord, I think about George right now and this pain he's having. Oh, Lord, that you would touch his body even now. That he would be okay. Be with Jerry, Lord, as she is concerned about her dad. Lord, we ask for prayer about this pastoral search that's so important to us. Lord, we would pray for your wisdom, your guidance, and your decision in this matter. And the same for our district superintendent, Lord. In the same way, we would ask that you would guide and lead our advisory board, and the committee taking care of this, Lord, at our district level. Would you lead and guide, Lord, today? Would you take over this moment, the Holy Spirit? Would you fill this place? Lord, would you allow me to preach out of control? That I preach the message that you have given? I'd be careful now to hand this all over to you, Lord, now. In your name, Jesus, amen. I don't know. I am I up here making some kind of racket? Maybe I need to tighten my screws. I may have one loose. Maybe more than one. Okay, we'll see about that. I don't know. But we'll leave that to the Lord. We'll tell Satan to get out of here. Stay away from all the technology. Have you ever given a gift to someone that has everything? Have you? Have you ever tried to give a gift to someone who has everything? Maybe it's your dad or mom or husband or wife or whoever it might be. They have everything. What are you going to give them? I think about my dad. He's hard to pick for. But he's cool. And that, so that makes it a little easier if I wanted to, if I really think about it. But typically I just say happy birthday to him, but he knows I love him to no end. But you know, to give a gift to someone who has everything, it's sometimes difficult. I mean, you know what I'm saying with that. I think that maybe that person that you're trying to get a gift for, they've given you fantastic gifts over the years. And you're like, how do I beat that? How do I give them something meaningful? Something that would be memorable, right? My kids try to do that with me. They do. They give me a lot of memorable things. And that's kind of where they're at with me. I'm going to get Dad something memorable. Something he won't forget. And also, you try to give something useful, right, to that person. I used to tell my kids when they'd ask me, Dad, what do you want for Christmas? Oh, give me some screwdrivers. Now I have 3 drawers full of screwdrivers and can't find any. Amen. Yeah, amen. Text me an amen on that if you can relate to that. But what about giving to God? How about God? Have you tried to give to God? Have you tried to figure out what he needs? Have you tried to think about what he would like to have? Have you thought about something memorable that he would remember you when he looks at it? Maybe something useful to God that he can use in heaven? And maybe something just meaningful. Have you thought about that? Perhaps you've considered giving God a gift. Maybe some of you have. Knowingly. In other words, you have given God a gift. And you know it. But what can I give to God? That's the question. What can I give to God? Shoot out a text. If you could think of something that you could give to God. Or maybe something you have given to God. She got a text and just mentioned that to me. I won't look at it right now, but I will look at it later. This thing is just not behaving with me. If it is me, it must be. Yeah, it's me. since it's Mother's Day, I'd like to share with moms an account from the Bible. An account about a woman named Hannah. And some of you will be familiar with Hannah. And as we will see, Hannah wanted a son. She wanted a son more than anything that she could think of. A son that she could cherish, a son that she could love. That's what Hannah wanted. She's been asking God for a son. This is the gift that Hannah wanted from God, is a son. However, today, I'm going to challenge all moms to think about a gift that you could give to God, not receive from Him. That would be my challenge to moms. Turn in your Bibles to 1 Samuel. Chapter 1. I'm going to try not to move up here too much. Seems like when I move, and I know I can't hardly talk without moving my hands. So don't ever tie my hands together because I won't be able to talk. In our story for today in 1 Samuel, we'll get to that in a moment, we are introduced to a man named Elkanah. Elkanah hails from the tribe of Ephraim. Ephraim is in the hill country just north of Jerusalem. That's where the tribe resides. That's where they live. And we also learn that Elkanah has 2 wives. He has Hannah and Peninnah. Now, I'm going to break right there. Do you think that's me? Is it?
Well, ask them on Facebook real quick if they're here.
Okay, on Facebook, text me if you hear all that noise and that rattling and crackling. Can you hear it? Okay, I wonder if that's... I'm not going to hold the mic. I cannot hold the mic because my hands can't move that. And I think we'll...
Do you want to maybe trade?
Well, yours is kind of probably about the same as mine sometimes. At least with me, it would be. Let me just get this thing... In case it's right in here. It might be in here. Isn't this wonderful? but it's real. Now, where was I at? I think that might help there. I think I had it back here and I might have been rubbing on those. Okay. Gotcha.
Two wives.
What's that?
Yeah,
she had two wives.
They all can hear it.
Okay. Everything good? Okay. Elkanah has two wives, as I indicated. Hannah and Peninnah. Now Hannah was his first wife, and he loves Hannah. I mean, he definitely has a thing for Hannah. But he wants children, so he has Peninnah, his second wife. And Peninnah has given him several children at this point in our scripture. But he does love Hannah. One thing about Elkanah that I want you to know is that Elkanah is a godly man. He loves the Lord. And every year he would go up to the high place for his tribe, that area, to a place called Shiloh. And you see that on the map. It's a yellow dot on that map up there. And that's where he would go to give sacrifices to God. And he would take his whole family with him. And we will enter our text with right at that point where he and his family are at the tabernacle at Shiloh, beginning in verse 4. And remember, this is, I'm going to read from the NIV here. And 1 Samuel chapter 1. Whenever the day came for Elkanah to sacrifice, he would give portions of the meat to his wife Peninnah and to all of her sons and daughters. But to Hannah, he gave a double portion because he loved her. And the Lord had closed her womb. Because the Lord had closed Hannah's womb, her rival kept provoking her in order to irritate her. Verse 7. This went on year after year. Whenever Hannah went up to the house of the Lord, her rival provoked her till she wept and would not eat. Her husband, Elkanah, would say to her, "Hannah, why are you weeping? Why don't you eat? Why are you downhearted? Don't I mean more to you than 10 sons? You know, we're being presented with some of Elkanah's family and their dynamics of their family here as a sample, really, of what it takes place at Shiloh every year that they go, when they go up there. On the one hand, Peninnah resents Hannah. She actually does, because Elkanah obviously loves Hannah more than he loves her. And she's given him children, but he still loves Hannah. Dr. Mellish, who teaches biblical literature at Olivet, he reminds us, Hannah means charming. The name means charming. It's kind of similar to a Hebrew word which means favor. And I think she gets Elkanah's favor. Even though Peninnah has given these multiple children to Elkanah, there is obviously something charming about Hannah, which draws Elkanah to her. Peninnah can readily see this attraction, and it makes her jealous. I think her heart just burns with jealousy. On the other hand, Hannah is hurt every time Peninnah reminds her that she has no children. That she can't give Elkanah any children. I tell you, she's unable to hold back the tears. We read that. That she cries bitterly. And I tell you, even Elkanah cannot comfort her. He cannot convince her that children aren't important. The question which begs to be answered is, what is it that really bothers Hannah? What is it? Is it really Peninnah's constant reminder that she can't give Elkanah any children? Is it that? Or does she just simply feel like a failure? A failure because she can't produce an heir for Elkanah. Or maybe it's because she is concerned about her own future. I mean, in those days, a woman, if she didn't have a son, I mean, all of the wealth of her husband would go away. She would have nothing. She would be homeless without a kinsman to take care of her. But is that it? Well, finally, on one of these yearly trips to Shiloh, things change. We read it from verse 9. Here's what we read. Once when they had finished eating and drinking in Shiloh, Hannah stood up. Now Eli the priest was sitting on his chair by the doorpost of the Lord's house. In her deep anguish, Hannah prayed to the Lord, weeping bitterly, and she made a vow, saying, Lord Almighty, if you will only look on your servant's misery and remember me, and not forget your servant, but give her a son, then I will give him to the Lord for all the days of his life, and no razor will ever be used on his head. Notice that Hannah is crying bitterly. I mean, she is distraught as she's praying for this son. She's praying for a son she doesn't have. My question for you this morning, when you are bitter, when you are distraught, when you are disappointed, who do you turn to? Mom, who do you turn to when you're down, when you're out? What do you expect from God? That's my question. We can see what Hannah wants. We can see that Hannah turns, who she turns to? She turns to God. And I believe that her vow to God tells what she expects from God. She's expecting God to give her a son that she'll give back to him. Hannah tells God that she wants to give, the most wonderful and dear gift back to God, a son that she doesn't even have. She said, if you will only look on your servant's misery and remember me and not forget your servant, but give her a son, then I will give him to the Lord for the days of his life. Wow. Hannah is consecrating her son that she doesn't have. She's consecrating him to the Lord for the Lord's purpose. She's giving back before she even receives. You see, this was a common practice in those days for those who trust the Lord. It was called the Nazarite vow, to give that child back to God. It was, when I think of this, what's not so common, even it was a common vow, is it was common for a woman to say that, a godly woman. But what wasn't so common there, I think, is why Hannah made the vow. That's what's not common. Notice what this says about Hannah as we looked at the scripture. Hannah does not simply want a son for her husband, right? I mean, her husband, remember what her husband said? You're worth 10 sons. I don't need a son from you. So she doesn't want a son for Elkanah. And she's not trying to prove Penina wrong. She just gets upset about that, that's all. And she's not asking for a son for herself. Not really. No, she's already given him away. She's not asking for a son for herself. She's asking for a son to give to God, to honor God. What a mom! She wants to honor her Lord. And she wants a son from the Lord to do that with. I tell you, if I were to read on in this account, we would learn that God heard Hannah's request. Or should I say her plea? And in due time, Hannah gave birth to a son and called him Samuel. Wow. Samuel. The prophet. Samuel that would come. Samuel that would give him a king. And another king. Right? And just as she had promised, Hannah took her son and gave him over to the priest Eli when he was old enough. She knew she was giving her son away. She knew that's why she wanted his son, to give to God. We read in verse 27 and 28, I prayed for this child, and the Lord has granted me what I asked for, or asked of him. So now I give him to the Lord. For his whole life he will be given over to the Lord. And he worshiped the Lord there. Hannah received her son from God, but as promised, she gave him back to God. Most people would look at that and say, doesn't make sense. Even today. But Samuel is Hannah's meaningful gift to God. Wow. Moms that are listening, watching, moms to be, what can you, a godly mom, give to God as a gift, even today? How about those loved ones who are so dear to you? Can you give them to God today? Have you? Maybe even those grandkids that you don't even have yet. Will you give them to God now? Or maybe even the great-grandkids. Will you give them to God? And like Hannah, don't take them back. Amen. You can text that. Amen. Don't give them back. I love grandkids. You see, when Hannah presents Samuel before the Lord to give him to God as she promised, she prayed. And I believe that in her prayer, moms, we can find examples of a godly mom. A godly mom. A godly mom, even a godly mom to be today. Turn to chapter 2, where I want to finish really this message to moms by looking at Hannah's prayer. We read there verse 1 of chapter 2. Then Hannah prayed and said, my heart rejoices in the Lord. In the Lord, my horn is lifted high. My mouth boasts over my enemies, for I delight in your deliverance. There is no one holy like the Lord. There is no one beside you. There is no rock like our God. That's what Hannah says. And I pray that we see in verse 1 that a godly mom will give praise to the Lord no matter what happens. A godly mom does that. Praise the Lord. You see, a godly mom never forgets what God has done for her and her family. Never forgets about the gifts God has given her. She knows her strength comes from God. And her words of praise become the evidence of God's grace in her life. A godly mom understands the call of God, the call that God has placed on her life, and the call that He's placed on her children. In Psalm 78, we see this call. We see it very clearly. Reading from verse 4 in Psalm 78, we will not hide these truths from our children. We will tell the next generation about the glorious deeds of the Lord, about His power and His mighty wonders, so the next generation might know them, even the children not yet born. And they will in turn will teach their own children. So each generation should set its hopes anew on God, not forgetting His glorious miracles and obeying His commands. Yes, a godly mom teaches her children about what God has done in her life. The children will know that mom praises God. What about it, mom? What about it? Will your children, will your grandchildren, will your great-grandchildren have a renewed hope because you praise God? And they hear you praise God. No matter what happens in life, even a terrible virus, you're praising God. And they know it. And more importantly, God knows it. Will this be your gift to God, Mom? Let's drop down to verse 6 in 1 Samuel chapter 2, where Hannah continues her prayer. The Lord brings death and makes alive, she says. He brings down to the grave and He raises up. The Lord sends poverty and wealth. He humbles and He exalts. He raises the poor from the dust and He lifts the needy from the ash heap. He seats them with princes and He has them inherit a throne of honor. For the foundations of the earth are the Lord's. On them He has set the world. Wow. That's a prayer. Moms, this tells us that a godly mom recognizes the power of the Lord, even if the world doesn't recognize it. Moms do. They know the power. As Hannah prayed, her words prove that she sees how powerful God is in her life and in the life of her children. Notice what she says about God's influence and His workings in her world. She says, the Lord brings, the Lord makes, the Lord raises, the Lord sends, the Lord humbles, the Lord exalts, the Lord lifts, the Lord seats. She uses these kinds of words in her prayer. He is Lord and she knows it. Thus, at the end of verse 8, Hannah proclaims, for the foundations of the earth are the Lord's. On them He has set the world. That includes her children. Hannah recognizes the power of the Lord. I know when I was a young teenager in 1968, My mom has been, I knew, I recognized that she had been given this same awareness that we see here about the pitfalls in my life, that she could see what I was facing. I mean, I that was a time, if you remember, in the 60s, the psychedelic drugs of that day and the so-called free love culture. You remember that, some of you? The anti-war, the anti-establishment, the anti-government movements. All of those could have taken me to places I didn't need to go. And my mom knew that. She recognized that. But praise to God. Praises to God. That my mom recognized the power of the Lord. She saw it. She saw what it could bring for me. And for my life, how that he humbles and how he exalts. My mom managed to pass on this awareness and recognition of God's power to me. Thank you, Mom. What about it, Mom? Moms, will your children, will your grandchildren, will your great-grandchildren, will they have an awareness of God's claim on their lives because you recognize the power of God? No matter what the world thinks, will this be your gift to God? And finally, Hannah testifies in her prayer, reading from verse 9, "He will guard the feet of his faithful servants, but the wicked will be silenced in the place of darkness. It is not by strength that one prevails. Those who oppose the Lord will be broken. The Most High will thunder from heaven. The Lord will judge the ends of the earth. He will give strength to his king and exalt the horn of his anointed." Hannah testifies to God's protection. God will protect her and her children. She knows it. She knows it will not be from her strength alone as a mom, even though she was a strong, godly mom. But rather, it comes from her faith in God. This passage made me think about these different home security systems that people are trying to sell all the time, right? You see them. Maybe you have one of them. You know, and I know I do. I have two or three of them. But, you know, the thing is that what they're selling you is protection, aren't they? They're selling you security when they sell these home security systems to us. But no doubt, I mean, I know they're good. They can be used and they do what they're supposed to do. They do try to protect you from a physical threat that you could see. But I tell you, the protection that Hannah is looking for, the protection that this mom is looking for her children, for her family, it's against something you cannot see. It's spiritual. That's what Hannah knew. That's the protection she knew God could give her, and it would be enough. God's protection is enough, Mom. She knows God has her back. Again, Mom, will your children, will your grandchildren, will your great-grandchildren believe that God's protection is enough because of your faith in God? Will this be your gift to God? Well, today I have challenged moms. What a challenge. Challenge moms to look at your relationship with God. And also look at your children's relationship with God. Praise Him. Recognize His power. And and see his protection for your children, for your family. Now, as the praise team comes, they're going to come and lead us in a closing song. And moms, I want you to think about your relationship with your children. That's what I want you to think about just for a moment here. There are some children today, some folks, some adults, who do not have a great mom. There are some. I have met them. I have talked to them. So I leave you, moms, with this poem. This is from Carlisa Smith. I don't know her, but she listened to what her words say. She says, "I am a girl that's sad. I wonder if people understand me. I hear people talking about me. I hear my people dying. I want a better life. I am a girl that's sad. I pretend to be happy. I feel like someone is out to kill me. I touch the skies of heaven. I worry about my life. I am a girl that's sad. I understand why my mom left me. I say I'll meet my mom. I dream about meeting my mom. I try to act like someone I'm not. I hope I can meet my mom. I am a girl that's sad." So there are folks today, there are some of you out there that you didn't have a good mom. And I know that, I think we always have to at least recognize that. That today, Mom's Day may not be the same for you as it is for others. But I certainly want you to know that God loves you. He wants to be your power and your protection. And He wants you to praise Him.
Inspire song.
Jesus' name. Moms, I want you to have a great and beautiful and wonderful day. You are so important to us. You make all the difference. I assure you all the work, the time and effort you have put into your children, and even into your grandchildren, perhaps even your great-grandchildren in some cases. It is, well, God's in it. God will be praised, and you and your family will know, spiritually for certain, His power and His protection. And I want you to know that today I'll be thinking about all you moms, I no doubt. And I'll certainly be thinking about my own mom and Yvette as a mom, and even my daughters who are moms now. But God has blessed us with you, and we are so thankful for you. Dear Lord, would you touch all moms? Would you touch them even now, and they would know just how important they really are? And Lord, would you touch that person who may not have had such a great mom? And would you let them know, Lord, that they are loved? That you made them, and that you have called them to make all the difference the world needs. Lord, we would be careful to give you all the glory.